food production system. And the first presentation is from, I hope I pronounce your name correctly, Gijs SCHILTHUIS, who is the head of unit for policy perspectives in the Directorate General for Agriculture and Rural Development of the European Commission. As you all know, a large part of the budget of the European Union is dedicated to food production systems, and the European Commission has a very important role in setting policies and priorities that deeply affect the way food is produced. So we'll hear from Gijs SCHILTHUIS, who will talk about sustainable food systems, the European Union experience. Thanks a lot for accepting our invitation, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. I hope you can hear me well.
Yeah.
I will try to share my screen. Let's see. Very good. Can you see the slides?
Yes, perfect.
Excellent. Thank you so much. It's really a pleasure for me to have the opportunity to speak to you and talk about sustainable food systems. Quite a switch from the very interesting scientific presentations that I was able to listen to before your coffee break. And it's especially a pity I can't be there, because I visited Trieste on several occasions and really loved the city. So it's a great pity that I have to do this from Brussels, but voila, that's the reality. What I would like to do with you is in fact talk a little bit about the Green Deal, which is in a way our main policy agenda, focusing on transforming the European economy in a sustainable way, and then talk about what I would call three experiences or three aspects of this in relation to food. And in that context, I will say a little bit about agricultural policy, because as you already kindly did, I work in agricultural policy in Brussels, so I have a bit more hands-on knowledge about that aspect of the food system. But I should like to underline right from the start already that when talking about a food system, we really mean the food system all the way to the consumer and beyond, the whole circular food system. So I want to start with a picture of the boss, so to say, Mrs. von der Leyen, but also because I think that she made some very interesting choices and remarks already in December 2019, when the European Commission adopted the Green Deal, really putting the net zero ambition in 2050 as the overall ambition of this college, with the Green Deal as the top priority. Rather different than previous European Commission. So the whole issue of sustainability, climate change, also now biodiversity, of course, is really central to the work of this commission. And I think it's also important that in this quote that you see, that she talks about an ecological transition. So really, it's not a technological fix, but it's really a transition of the way we work. And she called it Europe's man on the moon moment in one of her speeches in 2019. And I think with that, she refers to the importance of innovation, of knowledge, and also of technology in rolling out this strategy. And that's why I think it's very interesting that you are organizing this particular session also with a strong focus on knowledge and science in the challenge of finding sustainable societies. On the Green Deal, there's a lot going on. I'm not a specialist in everything. I will focus on what we call the farm to fork strategy, which is really the food aspect of this. But the strategy is much wider. You may recall only 2 weeks ago, the Commission published what we call a Green Deal industrial plan for the net zero age, which is all about clean technologies and making sure those technologies are developing and staying in Europe. And I think also what is important is to underline that you can see from all these initiatives that are part of the Green Deal that it's really about a growth strategy. It's not about more regulation, although of course regulation plays a role, but it's really about growth. And I think Professor Sachs would call this economic progress. It's not growth, just growth. It's really trying to create a better economic outcome. Food is central to all of this. Food is central to all of this. Why? Because it's an enormously important part of our economy. If you look at food, agriculture, the food industry, but also the whole restaurant industry, retail, it's the biggest sector of the European economy with incredible challenges. First of all, there is the need to reduce the environmental and climate footprint of the food system. And you can think of issues like food waste. You can think of the issues of water pollution, of air pollution. We've seen a number of slides demonstrating the damage that can be done by intensive agricultural systems or non-optimal agricultural systems to our natural environment. The other aspect of the food system is that it's very global. And that's also why the ambition that we have is not only to change the European food system, but really to reach out. And we do this through bilateral contacts in our free trade agreements that we are negotiating with a number of countries around the world. Sustainable food systems is an integral part, but also multilaterally. For example, the United Nations organized a Sustainable Food Systems Summit in September 2021, and there's now a follow-up to that in a number of coalitions, so multilateral coalitions, private sectors, universities, states, countries, all working together on different topics, from agroecology to sustainable productivity growth and many things in between. So I think this global transition where we try to lead and not try to impose is extremely extremely important, because as your presentations earlier have shown, this is really a global challenge, but also not an easy one. So we have to go step by step. I think that the third point on this slide links us to this economic growth aspect. Already, you spoke about rewarding farmers for storing carbon, the whole carbon economy. I think that's an opportunity for the food system. There's also a lot of opportunity in the bioeconomy. When we think about transitioning the economy to net zero in 2050, we need a lot of raw material, biomass. We need intelligent natural solutions to replace a lot of the chemical products that we use. So there's a tremendous opportunity for agricultural companies and for food processing companies to come with solutions that are part of a sustainable food system. So of course, then we move a bit beyond food, but I think it's very important to highlight this. And also within food itself, there are opportunities. One of the targets of our food strategy in Europe is to grow more organic. Not all of it organic, but we see a bigger place for organic farming. Why? Not only because it's good for biodiversity and it has other sustainability advantages, but also because there is a market for this. Market that is, I do recognize that, challenged by the high food prices linked to the food inflation situation in which we find ourselves. But even with this food inflation, we still see a quite considerable demand. And maybe the last point on this is the issue of resilience. And I think that really is extremely important in our farm to fork strategy. This strategy came out in May of 2020. So that was when we were in full lockdown. We're all working from home, and we were realizing how important a functioning food system is. I think many of us for the first time were queuing at a shop to be able to go in, to be able to buy food. Our delivery and logistical systems were under pressure. And I think the European food system got through this quite nicely. And thanks also to the hard work of many people in food industry, in farming, in retail, and so on and so forth. Also thanks to various officials in government agencies that were able to facilitate cross-border trade. But it did focus a lot on this aspect of resilience. How do you make sure that a food system weathers the storm? And now with the war in Ukraine and with the pressure from climate change, which we felt last year with the drought, and now also Northern Italy, of course, but also France already facing an enormous rain deficit, we realized that this issue of resilience is much broader and really should be a central feature of how we design a sustainable food system in the future. I don't want to dwell too long on the targets we set, but you have to realize that when we started with this Green Deal and with this farm to fork strategy, we said, okay, let's focus on a number of key objectives we want to reach and let's quantify them. These are what we say aspirational targets. They are targets that we've set because that focuses the minds. So a target on reduction of use of pesticides, a target to increase the area farmed organically, reduction of antibiotics, hugely important for the One Health component of our Green Deal. Nutrient losses, I already referred to that. Reducing nutrient losses is critically important, not reducing fertilizer gifts. Plants need to eat, but reducing the losses, being much more efficient. Also, improving and increasing the number of landscape features as a proxy for biodiversity. And of course, in the digital age, we need to make sure that the countryside is well connected to broadband. So all these targets are there to, in a way, focus our minds and focus the actions of public policymakers, but also of private companies. I said I was going to talk about the EU experience. So I wanted to talk about three experiences. And one is actually to underline that all this is new, this Green Deal. This is a new policy priority, but it didn't start in 2019. These graphs show changes in certain emissions over the past past two, three decades. Where you see in blue that the EU actually has been able for agriculture, not the food system, but for agriculture to reduce emissions, whereas in other parts of the world, this has gone up. Obviously, and I see that there's many scientists in the room, you know, you can play tricks with percentages. So you know that percentages don't say everything. But I think what is important to realize is that many efforts have been made by farmers, by food companies in the EU to already address the sustainability challenge. So we're on a path. And I think that's very important because one of the challenges of the Green Deal is not to set the targets, is not to come up with the great plans, but it is actually to implement them and to bring everybody along. We have 9 million farmers in Europe. We would all like for all these farmers to produce more efficiently, to produce with fewer emissions, to produce sustainably. So we need to get them along. We need them, in fact, to believe that making those investments, making those steps, changing their practices is the right way forward. And that is why we have a common agriculture policy. Chair, you already referred to the significant budgetary allocations that go into that policy, which is very important. And now with a reform that we concluded in 2021, a larger, much larger share of that money is actually going into practices, financing practices for sustainable farming. So that is key. I think another part of the another part of the ongoing change is to look at demand. And I picked up a slide here from our Outlook report for 2032, which the European Commission published in December, based on modeling work, on economic modeling work, where we show what we expect in terms of demand for, and in this case, meat, livestock, where we see a slight decline happening. So also in the big discussion about livestock and meat consumption, livestock being often in the place of criticism, even though we strongly believe that livestock has a place in agriculture, has an important place in agriculture, but needs to be sustainable, needs to be part of a circular agricultural system. But we see that consumers are already changing their behavior, slightly, but we expect this to continue and to slow down, which also means for farming that adjustments are necessary, because in our economy, you have to listen to and understand demand. Where is demand going? What changes are happening, and adjust your production system. So having these long-term perspectives in mind is extremely important. And talking about emission reductions that have happened, talking about demand that is changing, I think it's also important to underline that not everything is, what did I say in English, hunky-dory, everything's fine. Yeah, this is an important measure of biodiversity trends, which are not going very well, particularly here on farmland birds. So we also have the message to agriculture, to farmers, that much more needs to be done. So this first experience of the EU is, yes, much has already happened. I think the EU farming system is already performing extremely well at a global level in terms of sustainability, but not enough. Not enough, but things are changing. Farmers are changing, consumers are changing. A second experience, it's the experience of implementation. And this is a slide which has too many words, but all the different bullet points relate to different legislative and non-legislative initiatives that the European Commission is taking to change laws, to change policies, to help with this transition to a sustainable food system. Changes in relation to sustainable food production. I already talked about the Common Agricultural Policy. We have an action plan for organic farming. You may have heard about the fact that we have proposed legislation on the sustainable use of pesticides, which has run into some discussion and opposition in the legislative branches here in Brussels. We're working on, for example, nutrient management plans, also a proposal on new genomic techniques to facilitate their use in the EU. We are also talking about promoting shifts toward more healthy diets, food labeling, for example, but also a promotion program for agricultural products, and then focusing on sustainability. We're reviewing our school scheme. The EU helps finance school milk and fruit. Very important to also make sure that that is in line with our sustainability objectives. And then, of course, we are working also to ensure the sustainability is, you know, in the focus of food industry, retail, hospitality sector. So there's a range of actions also for that part of the food chain. And we're working on overarching legislation, what we call a legislative framework for sustainable food systems. So there is a lot of legislative initiatives that sort of help frame this transition. And in this list of initiatives, there is not even our very considerable research investment, for example, research investments and everything that has to do with food systems, climate, environment, our Horizon program, our soil mission. I found the presentation of the American professor on soil and regenerative agriculture very interesting. And I think this is really also reflected in our research work on soil. So many initiatives, but not always, and that's why I called it an EU experience, not always easy. Sometimes they say that making laws or making policies is like making sausages. I don't know if that's a very appropriate link or an appropriate image, but it gives you somewhat the idea that, you know, turning a Green Deal ambition into reality, you know, is hard work and also involves compromises. But I think overall we're on the right track. We are delivering, and I think also, as I've said in my previous slides, the sectors, the consumers, the farmers are also delivering, moving in the direction of sustainability. And then the last experience, and this is the last point that I will make, and then I'm happy to take a few questions. The last experience I want to underline is the experience of food security and resilience. I already talked a little bit about resilience when I spoke about the creation of this farm to fork strategy in the midst of the COVID lockdowns. And now we notice, of course, the importance of resilience in relation to climate change, which is what this map shows, the assessment of the potential changes in different parts of Europe in relation to climate change. But of course, what is also extremely important to mention in this context is the war in Ukraine, which has brought food security really high on the agenda. Food security, which has always been there, the European Treaty, the Treaty of Rome, contains a number of articles on agricultural policy that really have food security at their heart. And these articles from the Treaty of Rome have never been changed. They are still what we use to design our policies. But of course, the world has become in a way more complex. There are more things to be taken into account. So this issue of food security is really driving also the agenda, and is driving also some of the tensions in the debate about sustainability. For example, there would be some who would argue that we need to produce a lot of food now, but this shouldn't go, we would answer, to the detriment of our sustainability agenda, because we realize that the sustainability agenda is essential to be able to ensure food security in the long run. And in fact, the European Commission did an analysis of this, which was published in January, Drivers of Food Security, where we identified a lot of these drivers and these tensions. And what we are doing in our policymaking is really trying to combine the two, to invest in more sustainable farming systems, while at the same time ensuring that food is there today, and food is there also at a reasonable price, with food inflation on average of 18% in the EU in December. We're really looking at a rate of food inflation that is very difficult for many poorer households in the EU. So this dimension of food security, not only availability, but also affordability and access in the long run, and the resilience of the food system, are really aspects that needs and must be integrated in our work to develop sustainable food systems. So I hope with this short presentation, much less scientific than the previous ones, I've been able to give you a bit of insight into the work we're doing on making our food system more sustainable from the side of Brussels. And I'd be happy to take further questions. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for your very comprehensive presentation. I'll start with a question myself. You showed us that globally, Europe is doing much better than other large geographic areas in terms of the environmental impact of its agricultural system, with a net decrease in emissions, for example. But that's measured on the total surface area that we use for agriculture, and it doesn't tell us what the impact is on a per unit product basis. And one of the concerns is that we may decrease the impact on a per unit surface basis, but we may not produce enough. And so the net result of that will be that we'll have to import what we no longer produce ourselves from other countries that have a greater environmental impact. And I remember hearing one of your colleagues in the commission that was saying that in order to make the farm to fork strategy more effective, there was a thinking. So the commission was thinking about putting regulations on the food imports from other parts of the world, so that only food that is produced in a sustainable manner could be imported. Is that still on the agenda? Is that a concern or not?
Very good. This is a good question. There's a lot to answer. So first on the per unit emissions. So the fear would be that we would import products that would have a higher emission per unit from other countries. I always say that we have to measure and know, because it's not always better in Europe. So let's take this from an international perspective. I think that needs to be recognized. But for example, on climate emissions, we have been improving our per product emissions considerably. We've also been improving our trade balance. So we are exporting more. So far, the fear that we would be reducing production in Europe and importing more doesn't seem to hold true. In fact, if you look at EU food imports, we're importing tropical products, logically, and a considerable quantity of animal feed, mainly soya and maize. That would be our weakness. And another weakness would be the import of fertilizer and energy. And those are the weaknesses we identified in the context of the Ukraine crisis. So then, to your last question, are we going to impose regulation to avoid imports that are less sustainable? Well, we're part of the WTO, and the World Trade Organization provides us with a regulatory context, which we will respect, which means that you cannot impose just like that requirements on production methods. For example, an example that is used is for animal welfare, for example, but you can imagine all kinds of other things. There's a few areas where the Commission is thinking to restrain imports, which is, for example, in the area of antibiotics. Restrain imports is not the right word, where we would apply rules that are already valid in the EU also for imports. For example, because in the area of antibiotics, what we are fighting is the resistance to bacteria. We don't want the antibiotics to become less effective. And this is a global challenge. This is a global challenge where we believe that it merits to be addressed also at global level. So that is the sort of reasoning we are developing on this area, but it's not the case that we are developing a blanket legislation to block imports. On the contrary, in fact, we need trade. We don't believe that. We don't believe in restricting trade, also because from the perspective of food security, this would be unwise. It has been shown time and again that if we restrict trade too much, this is in the end to the detriment of food security. So we need to work with partners globally to improve sustainability rather than to work only with restrictions. I hope this answers your question, but we can discuss. I think you can organize a conference about this.
Yeah, thanks a lot. It was the answer was very complete. Thanks. Are there other questions from the floor or online?
I wonder. The question is the following. I mean, I presume that the way organization measure the level of sustainability of some action in the food or in other issues is different from country to country. Actually, is different maybe from city to city. There is any effort or anything that the EU is doing to give a sort of to try a sort of unification or harmonization of what it should be the level of measuring the degree of sustainability of the action.
Thank you. That's very important and interesting. I think you can measure at different levels. So for the strategy as a whole, we are developing the measuring a methodology for our key targets using a number of known indicators, but for some areas we're also trying to develop new indicators, particularly in the area of biodiversity, which is very difficult to measure specifically at a more aggregate scale. For some areas, we are working on much more specific measurement. And I'm thinking now, for example, about carbon farming, where we have proposed legislation that is in fact about how to measure carbon. What are the methodologies so that private investors who want to ensure carbon is stored by farming activities, that they know that what they're paying for is really happening, and that we also as public policymakers know what's happening. And this legislation is currently being discussed, and I think it's key. This is, in fact, this is the accounting system for carbon carbon farming that we are talking about. So there we also have we are trying really to harmonize methodologies. Another area of harmonization is related to labeling. So one of the initiatives that we are trying to develop is a sustainability label. There's a lot of labeling, and obviously labeling, the end goal of labeling is that you try to lure consumers into buying more sustainable products, but also companies to produce more of those sustainable products. And you need, for a label to be used on the internal market, you need a harmonized methodology. And that is what we are also working at. There are different initiatives in that regard, and it's not so easy, particularly also again in the area of biodiversity. So for example, an organic farm can score well on biodiversity, can score well on a number of other indicators, but maybe not on climate emissions, because there's a lower yield. So per product, you will have maybe more emissions. So how to balance those different aspects of environmental sustainability is complicated. So work is ongoing to try to find a good measure for that, and that would then apply for the whole EU market. I hope this.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much.
So thanks a lot for your very useful intervention. And I think we need to move on to avoid further delays. Thank again for accepting our invitation. And before we move to the next speaker, I just want to remind the participants